Hello, welcome to Career Conversations. And after a long time, today we've reinitiated this series, found a profile of a girl who is young, dynamic, and ambitious. She's a CA from November 2018. I am from November 2007, so she's from November 2018. So that's not really very unique, you know. She is she cleared a CA in the first attempt though, but she works with ICICI Bank, and that's a normal bread job. But the better part of her job is Instagram. She's got 99,000 plus followers on Instagram and is a social media influencer in the true sense of the word. And that's why I thought I'll bring her on this show and make her share those experiences, which are really unique. So welcome to the show, Ria. And tell us more about your school and college in the first place. What are those events which shaped you as a person, helped you evolve and, you know, break into the next orbit of performance?
So I did my schooling from Rajasthan Vidya Mandir, and the entire confidence that I have in me right now is a gift from my school itself. It's not a very famous school, but it has helped me shape me as a person, my personality a lot. So I started off my schooling, my education as a very average student. I was like the okayish kid in class who is not so famous, and nobody knows about that kid in the class because that kid sits in the last bench and usually keeps quiet, doesn't talk to anybody or anything. And then when I grew up and we hit the senior section, like in standard 6 or 7, I started failing. Like, I didn't understand what was going on in the classes. I didn't read, I didn't write. And I used to fail in the most important subjects like English, Hindi. And then one day a new teacher joined our school. I think it was in standard 8, and I failed in her subject. So she insulted me in front of the whole class, and the whole class started laughing. As usual, if any kid gets insulted, the class usually laughs. So that hurt my ego a lot, and I started studying. And the next thing we knew was that I topped my class in the next term. So that's how it hit it off. And in standard 9th and 10th, I was the topper for my school in the boards exams. And the best part was that she was a Hindi teacher, the teacher who insulted me, and I topped in Hindi all over West Bengal. And then I went to her and I told her this. I showed her my result, and she was like, she couldn't believe it that the girl who used to fail, who she used to insult in the class, topped entirely in West Bengal. So after I improved in my academics, I used to participate a lot in extracurricular activities also, like debates, dancing and all. So I was made the head girl of the school, and I used to arrange a lot of activities and events in my school. And this continued for, I think, 3 years for standard 10th, 11th and 12th. And that's how I gained so much of confidence to do things that I wanted to do, to lead a large number of people. And in college, I'm from Bhavanipur College. I was a part of their art group called AIMS. And I used to attend a lot of workshops and events that was conducted by the college at that time. Basically, writing events, like creative writing. I was very interested in creative writing at that point of time. We even organized an event to meet Ruskin Bond. I think it was in second year of college. So that's how my schooling and college helped me to get in the creative field, the creative part of my life.
So then you're the eldest of 3 siblings. Did not have someone, yes, whom you would just imitate in terms of career choices. Then how did CA happen?
CA, actually, I always wanted to be a fashion designer. So one day I was just sitting at home and my father came to me. It was in standard 11th, and he asked me, what are you planning to do after 12th? I said, I have thought about doing fashion design. He said, yeah, you can go ahead with that, but why not give CA a shot? Like, you have become good in academics, just give it a shot. I was like, okay. So when we got over with, I think, class 12 boards, at that time we could have given boards, our CA exams just after our boards. Like, boards ended in March and CA, CPT was in June, I think. So just because I improved in academics, I gained a lot of overconfidence at that point of time. And I failed in CPT in the first attempt. And like, my father couldn't believe it. I actually failed. And I was like, I cried the entire day that how could I fail? I used to top in my exams in school. I was a topper in 10th and 12th. And how could I fail? So he said that give it a try again. So I tried again in December, in the December attempt, and I passed that time. So I was like, okay, if I can do this, I can study and clear the whole course. So I just went on for IPCC. I gave my IPCC. I cleared it in the first shot, and then came the articleship phase. So the first place, I actually did my articleship from 2 places. I took a transfer from my first office. So I think I was there for around 3.5 months. And the second office, which majorly shaped my career, was KS Bothra & Company. I was there for 2 years, 9 months. And It taught me a lot of things, like all the sectors. I was not confined to a single, you know, audit terms or in taxation terms. I was given a taste of every field. So I learned a lot, especially my principal whom I was working under. He was like a very friendly one. Everybody talks about articleship, like it's very scary. But my articleship experience was a very nice one. Like I was very happy doing my articleship. I used to go to office happily, work happily. We were a team of 45 articles at that time in that particular office. So my seniors were also very great and my juniors, they were also very sweet. So I learned a lot of things during my articleship. And yes, that's how it all went. And then came finals. Like everybody was talking about tuitions, kahan se le, where to take your tuitions from. Everybody was discussing this teacher, that teacher. And I did not take any tuitions. I was like, okay. I actually enrolled for two, accounts and costs. I was enrolled for the old syllabus. And that's when an announcement came from ICAI that they're launching a new syllabus and people who wanted to shift could shift to the new syllabus. So I went for those old syllabus tuitions, I think, for a month. And then I decided that, no, this is not what I want to do. I want to shift to the new syllabus. And I shifted within a week of that announcement, I think. And I stopped going to tuitions because nothing was getting in my head in tuitions, honestly. So whatever I learned in audit and tax was entirely practical in terms of my articleship. There was no theoretical knowledge that I gained from any book. And that only helped me in my exams, to be very honest, because I studied for 3 months before exam. I started studying in August and exams were in November. And I hadn't taken any tuition. So everybody was like, how will you do it? You don't have any notes. You don't have any concept. I was like, I'll figure it out somehow. So I started studying from the institute's material. Everybody is like, follow this tuition teacher's book or follow that book. But I was like, no, I'll follow the institute's material. And actually it helped a lot. It cleared all my basic concepts about everything. And I went off to give the exams and I did pretty well. And I knew I would clear group one. But group two, I was a little dicey because of one subject. But then I cleared that too. And I was really happy. But the most important thing that I figured out during these exams were how important was it to take a break. I literally went on a 2-day random vacation with unknown people in September while I knew my exams were in November. And that helped me get that refreshment between those days. And, you know, I could just come back and start afresh. And the things that were done for a moment. And then I started with the whole pile of books that were in front of me after that break. So that one little break was very important. Otherwise, I think I would have been just stubbed under the pressure of just completing the entire syllabus and everything.
And then ICICI Bank happened to the campus. So what do you do there for bread?
No, I am not through campus. I did not join ICICI through campus, actually. I first went off to give 3 different interviews in which there were some or the other factors about those companies that I thought wouldn't suit me in the long term. So that's when I got contacted by an agency, a recruiting agency, and they told me that there was an interview with ICICI Bank happening in the next week. And it was for a credit role. So I was quite interested by it and I went for the interview. And the people who were taking the interview explained the whole job profile to me like really well. And I thought that, yes, this is what I want to do. And after the whole interview was done, I was just hoping and praying that I get this because this was exactly what I wanted in my career, spontaneity. Like I did not want to do something which I know that, okay, in this month I have to do this, in that month I have to do this. I wanted a job which would be ever-changing, like in which I would get to learn a lot of things. What happens in credit is you get so many different ideas about different businesses. You get to learn something new every day. There's no boring job profile, like you have to do this or you have to do that. There's no set of rules. You get a new file every day and then you decide and then you to know about the business. It's completely changing every day. So I think was the best career option available for me at that point of time.
Now coming to the interesting part, how did Instagram happen? Was it serendipity? You just stumbled upon this, some senior suggested your looks, someone said just pose and you started getting traction. What happened really?
I never knew that there was this whole world of influencing inside Instagram. I just started off one day. I just opened an account on Instagram and there were 2 friends of mine who knew that I write a lot. So just like creative writing, I used to write a lot of quotes. So they said, why not open a page where you could post your quotes? I was like, yes, the idea seems fine. So I started posting a lot of my quotes on Instagram, and it actually got pretty famous. Within the first 4 to 5 months, I think I gained 15,000 followers. So I didn't know that influencing was a business 3 years back. I'm talking about January 16. I just finished with my IPCC exams. The results were not even out. So that's when I started posting my quotes. And when around in June 2016, I hit off around 15,000 followers. And that's when I got a message from a gentleman in my DM, the inbox on Instagram, that, hey, I'm from this company. It was actually Whistle Snacks, my first ever brand collaboration. And he asked that, would you like to promote our brand on your page? And I was like, I had no idea about how all this happened. So I asked him that, what are you looking for? And he just told me that they were a new snacks company who were going to launch in India, and they were looking for some people with a huge social media presence to promote their brand for. So I said, okay, so what is my benefit if I promote your brand out of it? He said that we send you a hamper out of it. I didn't know that I could actually charge for it. So I agreed for it. So basically the first few collaborations that I did were completely barter, because I was new. I didn't know anybody who was in this profile or in this profession. And I didn't know that I could actually charge for posting for branded stuff. So that's how it all started. And then within first two to three months, there are actually different influencing agencies also, which connect brands to the influencers. So I was connected by one such agency, which is called Plixo. It was a new platform launched by PopExo. So they were new, I was new, and I thought, why not make a profile on this, right? So I just went on and I made a profile on Plixo. So that's when different brands started looking at my profile through Plixo. And I started getting a lot of brand collaborations over my emails from that. So that's how the whole Instagram thing started. And through Plixo is that I got to know that I could actually charge for what I'm posting. So from that time onwards, I started charging the brands for their content that I was posting on my channel.
What is the typical money that is involved in this? How much can you charge a post?
It's exactly based on the number of impressions that we create. When we have a business page on Instagram, we usually get to see the graphs, the weekly graphs of how many people are actually watching those posts. So the traction basically is, it's 1 rupee per impression, right? So if my post reaches around 10,000 people, then I get 10,000 for that one particular post. That is the general scenario right now all over the world for all the influencers. So yes, if my post is reaching 10,000 people, I get 10,000 for it. If my post is reaching 5,000 people, I get 5,000 for it. It was the scenario back in 2017 when I started off with Plixo. But as and when people started knowing about this influencing industry, a lot of new college students, school students started getting into influencing industry. And that's when brands decided to somewhat exploit here the new students, the newbies, and they started doing things for barter, for like long term. They used to get into contracts like 1 year contract and all for long term, right? So the newbies didn't know that they could charge for it. Just like me, I didn't know that I could charge for it. So they started doing it for barter. And now what the basic scenario is, the payment has actually become half of what it was before. Because so many people have entered the industry that if I say no, there are 5 more people waiting to do that.
So now it's like 50 paisa per impression. That's the kind of rate.
Right. Market. Right. That's the kind of rate right now.
And so two things which I think are really very difficult. One is like that shooting part. So that one final pic which is posted on Instagram gets all this traction. I don't think that's the first pick. So is it like a day long effort where you try different variants of that same shoot? And your sister is there. She's a photographer, I suppose. Ria Goenka.
Right. My sister is a photographer.
Yes. Footer of all of those posts. So I think it's quite a task to get the final, that one accurate pitch.
Right. The main part is to get a location where we can shoot with the appropriate lighting and all, because most of the brands, they prefer outdoor shoots. So we cannot shoot everything online with, you know, those artificial lights and all. They want natural lighting, a proper background. So the main task is that we head out, find a good background where proper lighting, natural lighting is available. And then when we start shooting, it's not like when we get the first picture, it's like the perfect picture and we can post it. There are like 120 pictures around, out of which we select that one picture which should go up on the profile. And many times it happens that we select 5 to 6 pictures and then we send it to the brand for approval. And they select the picture which suits their product the best. And that is what is posted on our channel. And a lot of editing also goes through it. It's not like I look like that all the time. So it's not like that. A lot of editing is done on that one particular picture to make it look like the perfect picture for the brand and for my channel as well.
And then from 15,000 followers, how did 99,000 followers happen? I mean, just organically?
No. The major thing that I learned, I started following a lot of other influencers who were already established in the industry. So one thing that I noticed that they were hosting a lot of giveaways, a lot of contests on their feed to attract new people to follow them. So what this basically is that you collaborate with a brand or more than a brand, like 2 to 3 brands together, and you curate a hamper for your followers. There are a set of rules that the new people or the existing people have to get in their friends to follow your profile to win that particular hamper. So, you know, winning something creates a lot of excitement amongst the generation, our kind of generation, who is like, okay, they want to try new products all the time. So if you are getting it for free by just following a person, why not? So that's when brands started collaborating, and I used to give them an offer that instead of a normal collaboration, why not go for a giveaway? That will get you followers, that will get me followers, and that will generate an excitement amongst the people about your brand, about winning products from your brand. So that is when a lot of following started dropping in to just win those products. So I used to host these giveaways like 1 in every 2 months, and that is how I gained so many followers in a short span of time.
So my YouTube channel has got some 46,000 subscribers now. I should give some takeaways, some gift hampers to visit guys to a lakh. So I think with that kind of fan following, has it ever happened that you are just randomly traveling in a metro or you are at some event and suddenly someone recognizes you that, oh, you are Ria, I follow you on Instagram. Has such event happened?
It happened twice with me. Once I was in a movie hall, I was sitting in PVR with my family, and there was a guy sitting next to me, and he was like, you're Ria Goenka, right? I follow you on Instagram. And my father was looking at me like this. And the second time it happened was when I was going for office during my articleship times, and there was a guy sitting in front of in the auto, and there was a guy sitting at the back, and both of them were you know, in a low tone arguing that this is Ria Goenka, no, this is not Ria Goenka, no, I'm telling you this is Ria Goenka, oh no, I'm telling you this is not Ria Goenka. And then I turned towards them and I told them that I am Ria Goenka. That was quite a funny incident that happened.
And what's the flip side of having that kind of fan following? Do you get stalked by fans who said, I love you and this and that? All those things happen? The flip side of
social media? My inbox is actually full of messages like, I love you, can we have a video call? Hi, hey, what's up, beautiful? So I usually ignore these messages. But one thing that I couldn't ignore once was somebody actually recreated my profile with another name and posted all my pictures on that profile and actually gained 3,000 followers in just 2 days. And I had no idea about it. So one of my followers just randomly sent me a screenshot of that profile. And then I was really scared because that was the first time that somebody had tried to impersonate me on social media and was using my pictures and videos. And that person had already blocked me so that I couldn't see the profile. So I then reported it to Instagram and brought the Instagram profile down with the help of my followers. Like, a lot of people reported that profile and that profile was put down.
But yeah, quite interesting. I think had you been just a normal CA doing normal credit job, life wouldn't have been so exciting without this Instagram part. So what are your future plans here?
What I want is to make this thing bigger. Like, there are a lot of big brands right now which I haven't worked with till now, and I want to work with them. Like, I am basically working in the fashion and beauty niche right now, and I want to work in the lifestyle zone also. Like, I want to get in touch with more fashion related brands and beauty brands. Like, there are a lot of brands. I recently worked with Pons. So Pons is a very big brand. So there are a lot of brands out there right now which I want to work with. So basically the future plan is to gain more followers, first of all, and become so good at my own work that brands want to work with me. That, like, if they think of launching their product in Kolkata, that first name that should come in their mind should be Ria Goenka.
Oh my God, that's quite ambitious, and I'm sure you're going to achieve that. So, final thoughts in terms of what would be advice to future aspirants for CA, for doing something out of the box like your Instagram thing? What would be your piece of advice?
My piece of advice would be just not to just confine yourself into one degree. Like, you should not have just one source of income in the present given scenario right now. Like, there should be 2 to 3 sources from where you get money flowing in. One should be from where you know you can get a fixed amount every month. I feel that, because having a fixed amount is a lot of security in today's life, right? And the another one is something that you actually love doing, that you get happiness out of. So Instagram for me is something that I derive a lot of happiness out from. I love doing it. Even if I don't get a lot of money from it in a month, I would happily do it because it interests me a lot. So having something in life that you are excited for doing every day, like you wake up every day and you know that, okay, I have to shoot for this brand today. You get excited for something in life. You know, you have that little pop up in your heart when you think that, okay, you have to go for this shoot today, or you have to go for that shoot the next day. So there should be one exciting element in life along with your regular job or your business, whatever you are doing. There should be one thing that actually interests you to do it. So career and all, doing CA is fine, doing MBA is fine, whatever your career choice is fine, but what you actually love doing in the creative field, it could be anything. Like for me, it's Instagram. For somebody, it could be dancing. For somebody, it could be singing. So just never stop doing that, because you never know what you can make out of it if you just use the right resources and put your efforts at the right place. And for the aspiring CAs, I think the most important piece of advice that I would give is studying is fine, working is fine, but taking breaks is a very important thing. You should know where to stop, because that pressure just gets too much at some time, some point of time, and it's like a breakdown for everybody. So that's when you know you should take a break. Just go off somewhere, be it for a movie or be it for a lunch. Just relax yourself. It's not like if you won't study a chapter a day, so you'll fail. It's not like that. You can study 2 chapters a day and then take a break off the next day. There is no hard and fast rule of doing it. Just keep your mind relaxed at all point of time.
And during your break, follow Ria on Instagram and keep checking.
Yes, follow me on Instagram. Yes.
And for Ria's followers, follow me on YouTube, because this
yes, on YouTube. I'll put the link.
All right, Ria. Thank you so much for this
thank
short
you.
But very exciting conversation. I'm sure the readers of the transcript, as well as the ones who've been watching this, will really enjoy this. Thank you so much. All the best.
Thank Bye. You.